is the third part of a three-part series, Imitators of God. Wednesday before last, we dealt with living in love. We talked about what it meant to live in love. Last Sunday, we dealt with living in the light. And we talked about how living in the light energizes our spiritual growth and exposes our sinful nature. We talked about living in the light of our salvation. This morning, I would ask that you would prayerfully consider living in wisdom. Living in wisdom. Living in wisdom. Beloved, there is a difference between having knowledge and having wisdom. There's a difference between having knowledge and having wisdom. Yes. Having knowledge is the ability to accumulate and absorb facts and data. To be able to accumulate those things and take them. But wisdom is the ability to apply or to properly apply that knowledge to our lives. I'll use my preaching voice when I say that. Wisdom is the ability to properly apply that knowledge to our lives. In chapter 5, Paul encourages us to be imitators of God by living a certain way. To be imitators of God means that our lifestyle should reflect the fact that we know Jesus. It's just not something that we do on Sundays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays. It's not just a few hours a week, but being imitators of God is a lifestyle. It's all day, every day. But for too many of us, being a Christian is just like any other organization we join. We do it only when we have time for it. We are Christians only when it suits our schedule. When it fits into our daily grind. Being a Christian is not something we are for most of us. It's just something that we do. And we associate being a Christian to the things that we do. We are Christians because we come to church and we come to Bible school and Sunday school and choir practice and meetings and conferences. But being a Christian is not something that we do, it's something that we are. Being a Christian is a lifestyle. We talk like this because we are Christian. We walk like this because we are Christian. It's just not some organization that we join because we want to escape the fiery pits of hell. But being a Christian is a lifestyle change. And Paul talks about being imitators of God. And this lifestyle change needs to incorporate living in wisdom. It needs to incorporate living in wisdom. Let's look at this text and let's see what it says. Verses 15 and 16. Verse 15 is the foundational verse, which says, "See that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil." There are some principles that I want to give you here for being wise and for living in wisdom. The first principle is living in wisdom means understanding the days we live in. Understanding is a part of wisdom. Verse 16 spells it out, that redeeming the days that we live in because these days are evil. Brothers and sisters, I hope I don't have to tell you this, or I hope you haven't heard this for the first time, but we are living in evil days. If you don't believe it, all you have to do is cut on the TV. Go on your Twitter feed, your Facebook tweet. It doesn't matter what it is. But you will quickly discover that the days that we are living in are evil. We are living in a time where people don't care anything about the church or God. Now, just so you'll understand what this looks like, 2 Timothy 3 says it best. So you don't think I made this up. But it says, you should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times. For people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unholy and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from people like that. Understanding the times we live in is critical to living in wisdom. Understanding that the days that we see now are days where people will be lovers of themselves more than lovers of God. If you wonder why the world is in the shape that it's in, all you need to understand is that the days that we're living in are evil. Amen, somebody. People will often say, well, what's happening to the world? The danger for Christians is looking at the world and becoming discouraged. That's really the danger. Is seeing everything around us and then begin to wonder, where is God? That's the trap. You have no understanding that God says these days are supposed to be like this. God has set in motion some things that are supposed to happen. Let me give you this nugget. Stop trying to prevent what God has already ordained to happen. Wow. See, there's some things you can't change. There's some people you can't change. Some people are always going to be the way they are. Some circumstances, no matter how much you pray, are always going to be the same way. And you have to understand that the days that we're living in are evil. We live in a fallen world. And we are called to be light in a fallen world. But we still live in a fallen world. And what happens is the enemy begins to have us believe that God doesn't love us because of the shape that the world is in. That is a trick of the enemy. We have to understand that we live in this time. It's important that you understand that. It is the beginning of walking in wisdom or living in wisdom. That is understanding that the days that we live in are evil. He said, and guess what that means? Don't waste your time. You can put that however you want to apply that, but don't waste your time, because the days that we live in are evil. Be about God's business. I'll let that sit there and simmer for just a minute. We'll cut it on low and let that just simmer for a minute until it starts to kind of bubble. But understanding the days that we live in, because understanding is the first part of knowledge or wisdom. It's understanding. You got to have some understanding for you to have wisdom. Okay, you got to have some understanding. There's another principle here that I want to share with you. Living in wisdom means understanding God's will for our lives. That's verse 17. Verse 17 says, therefore, do not be unwise, but understand the will, what the will of the Lord is. Another concept of understanding is understanding God's will for our lives. When I tell people understand the will, God's will for your life, they look at me puzzled. They say, how do you understand God's will for your life? When I ask them, do you understand what God's purpose is for your life, your God's will for your life? They look at me, well, you know, how do I understand that? Let me give you a key verse, Romans 12 and 2. Let me give you a verse for that. It says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So how do you do it? You have to have a renewed mind in order to understand God's will for your life. Our minds must be transformed from the things of this world to the things of God. You have to have a mind change to understand God's will for your life. What do I mean to have a mind change? You have to change your thinking. That means you have to get rid of worldly thinking. Get rid of stinking thinking and fill your mind with the things of God. See, a lot of us spend too much time thinking about other things other than the will of God. Most of the things we think about have nothing to do with the will of God for our lives. You have no idea how this applies to God's will for your life because your mind is not on God's will for your life. Your mind is on how you're going to make it through to tomorrow. Instead of thinking about how today applies to God's will for your life. See, most of us don't understand that the things that happen to us have a purpose. I know I ain't going to get no amen behind that, but that's okay. That's okay. You don't have to amen that. I understand. See, I've been on this journey a little while, and then I have the perspective of looking back and seeing everything that has happened to me. And I can tell you life ain't been no crystal stair. I can tell you life ain't been full of roses. Matter of fact, since I've been preaching, I said there have probably been more thorns than roses. But nonetheless, when I look back, I see God's purpose for my life in the thorns. See, most of us are trying to avoid the thorns. We're trying to avoid all of the ill things that come with this life. And we're trying to believe that just because we're saved, that entitles us to a free pass. I shouldn't have to go through this. I'm a child of God. I'm a good person. I pay my tithes and my offering. I'm a member of Lomax Temple in good standing. I serve on all the boards there are. I teach Sunday school, Bible study, preach, teach, pray. Why is this happening to me? Why am I going through? Why am I dealing with this if I'm a child of God? Beloved, when we change our mindset, then we begin to understand what God's will for us is in going through what we're going through. All right. See, that's wisdom. Wisdom doesn't say, why am I going through this? Or, I've done good. What did I do to deserve this? Wisdom really says, why am I going through this? What part does this play in God's will for my life? Ask yourself, what does this have to do with God's will for my life? If we begin to look at every situation that we're dealing with right now and flip the script from saying, why is this happening to me, to what does this have to do with God's will for my life? Then we begin to understand and begin to walk in wisdom, because now we're not living for what we can get out of it. We are living for what God can get out of it. Right. And when you begin to live for what God can get out of your life, your whole thinking changes. There has to be a change in thinking. See, you're not the first person to go through something. You won't be the last person to go through something. Whether you're a child of God or not, the Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust, no matter who you are. You're just going to go through stuff. That's just a part of living this life. But when you have a change of mind and you begin to live in wisdom, then you say, what I'm going through must have a purpose. And what I begin to look for is understanding. Why did this happen to me? Let me talk to you like we know each other. My wife and I first got married, I was preaching, but I really hadn't gone through anything yet. We didn't have a whole lot. We had two nickels rubbed together. Well, we had a nickel and a penny rubbed together. We really had two nickels rubbed together. Now, I ain't gonna tell you all my story, but there were several occasions where we could barely make it, where we've had our lights turned off, I don't mind telling you, where we had barely enough groceries in the refrigerator to feed our kids. We went through that, and there were people in the church who didn't know what we were going through. And there were family members who didn't know that we were going through, because we were very prideful, but they would bless us. And it was a blessing to us. And I was unaccepting of those gifts at first, because I was too prideful and I didn't understand what God was doing in my life. Now fast forward maybe 10 years. I ain't saying we rich, but we better than we are. We can rub two nickels together. Now I'm the pastor of a church, and someone comes to me and says, I don't have enough to pay my utilities. I don't have any food in my refrigerator. And I look back at what I went through, and it helps me gain perspective and empathy. Let me help you. If I didn't go through what I went through, I wouldn't be able to minister to people who are going through what I went through. See, you. I want you to get this, because some of you are going through things so you can get perspective and you can gain some empathy. So when people come across your path, you can look back at your life and see what you've gone through and be a blessing to them as they go through it. And they will thank God for you. And see, the issue is, you didn't thank God for going through what you went through at the time, because I know I didn't. See, I didn't thank God for what I was going through at the time, because I thought God was picking on me. I thought God didn't love me. I thought God, matter of fact, I must have done something wrong. I must have picked the wrong profession, because I was preaching his word and I couldn't see it, because I've been taught some kind of false theology that just because I'm a child of God means I'm going to be blessed and highly favored and I'm going to have everything I need. And I want to tell you, that's not always the case. But he took me through trial after trial after tribulation so I could gain some wisdom, that when I come out, now when someone I run across or someone in my path is going through the same thing, I can say, look, I've been where you are. And not only have I been where you are, but let me help you where you are. And that perspective only comes from when you go through something. So what I'm saying to you is, what you're going through is no coincidence. it's no accident. If you're going through sickness right now, if you're going through lack right now, it is designed to give you wisdom that when people you run across are going through the same thing, beloved, you can be a blessing to them. Because wisdom doesn't come on the front end. Boy, I wish somebody would have told me that in the beginning. Wisdom doesn't come on the front end. It comes after you've been through something. And understanding that is a principle to living in wisdom. So now, I understand the times that I live in. And I understand God's purpose for my life. Now, those two principles allows me to apply the last principle. Because now, there's a principle that I have to use. After I understand these two things, then I have to have some application. It does you no good to have wisdom if you never use it. It does you no good to understand all these things, amen, and you can't apply it to your life. So now I understand the times in which I live. And I understand that I'm supposed to live in a way of God's purpose for my life. I'm supposed to understand God's purpose for my life. And these two principles allow me to apply the last one, which I want to put into practice. And it says it allows me to live a spirit-filled life. So understanding the times in which I live and understanding God's will for my life allows me to live a spirit-filled life. Yes. The first two principles give us understanding, but the last principle allows us to put it into practice. It does you no good if you don't put it into practice. God intended us to live a Holy Spirit-filled life. What does that mean? A life that is influenced by the Spirit. Let me ask you a question. What's influencing your life? Let me just ask you, what is influencing your life? Your friends? Your economics? Your environment? Your emotional state? What is influencing your life? What is it? We are called to live spirit-filled lives. That the Spirit of God that lives in us is supposed to lead us in how we live. It's supposed to lead us in how we live. Not our friends, not our families, not our bank accounts, not our education. Nothing else is supposed to lead us in the life that we're supposed to live. Not the jobs we have, even though we spend a lot of time on our jobs. They're not supposed to lead us in the way we live. What do I mean? They are not supposed to influence us. We are supposed to influence them. That means the way that the things outside of us are supposed to be influenced by us and not the other way around. You're not supposed to be influenced by your job. Your job should be influenced by you. Your bank account should not be influenced by you. You should influence your bank account. But for most of us, we live a life that is influenced by the things around us. Can I just speak plain to you? When we have a lot, we live better. When we have little, we live less better. I like that one. So look, if all things are going good on the job, in the house, we live better. If mama's happy, kids are happy, everybody's happy, then I'm happy. Living a spirit-filled life means this. Regardless to what's going on around me, I'm still being led by the Spirit. That what is influencing me to live the way I live is not how you treat me. It's not what's in my account. It's not on the degrees on my wall. It's not by where I live, nor where I work, but it's by the Spirit that lives in me. That when I live a Spirit-led life, what happens is I live every day by the Spirit that lives in me. God is directing my path. God is directing my words. God is directing my walk. God is directing my talk. God is directing how I give. God is directing how I live. God is directing how I treat others, not how others treat me. I'm not being influenced whether you smile at me or not, whether you say hi to me or not, whether you grin at me or not, but I'm influenced by what God is saying to me in my spirit. You cannot affect me to live outside of being Spirit-led. Too many of us are being influenced by the things around us. We are being influenced by things around us. And that's an issue, because then we're not living a Spirit-led life. We're living an issues-led life. We're living a concerns-led life. Y'all not going to talk back to me, but it's okay. Because guess what? When you're living a Spirit-filled life, there are two ways you can tell this. See, I'm living a Spirit-filled life means I'm living a life filled with praise. Verse 19. I'm almost done. Verse 19. I'm almost done. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. That when I'm living a Spirit-filled life, I'm living a life filled with praise. That means, and it's another way of means, that I'm living a life filled with holy conversation. I want to say that one more time. I'm living a life filled with holy conversation. My words are filled with conversations about God and his goodness. What are your conversations filled with? I'm not talking about from 11 to 3 on Sunday, on Wednesday, on Thursday, on Tuesday. But I'm talking about on Monday morning, on Tuesday afternoon, on Saturday night. What are your conversations filled with? See, when you are living a Spirit-led life, you are living a life filled with holy conversation. That means eventually if you talk to somebody long enough, some praise is going to come out your mouth. You're going to talk about Jesus. If someone talks to you long enough, they're going to hear about Jesus. Our conversations must be filled with praise. Holy conversation. Instead of gossiping, instead of backbiting, to one another, about one another, because I know we don't talk about one another in here. I know we don't do that. I'm just talking about, we talk to one another about somebody else, but not to one another about one another. But let our conversation be filled with praise. Let me help you. If you're always talking to people, or you always find yourself in conversations with people that are always negative, always about gossiping, always about backbiting, this is how you get rid of them. Start talking about Jesus. I'm going to help you right there. If your phone ring, pring, and they pick up the phone, girl, let me tell you, man, let me tell you what happened over here. Look, let me help you get rid of them. It's better. It'll work with bill collectors, too. Not that I know anything about that. I'm just saying. But if you talk about Jesus, it'll change the tone of the conversation. Most people don't want to stay on the phone. If they got some itchy gossip to tell you and you start talking about Jesus, they're going to find somebody else to tell it to. You have to change your conversation If you want to change who you're talking to, and you want to change who talks to you about certain things, start filling your conversation with Jesus. I guarantee they'll stop calling you. If you start saying, well, girl, let's pray about it. Man, look, let's not talk about them. Let's pray about it. Let's pray for them. They ain't going to call you no more. They're not going to call you. They're going to find somebody that's going to feed what they want to talk about. But when you don't feed what they're talking about, they'll find someone else who will. And the way to stop feeding that backbiting, that gossiping, is to start filling your conversation with God. Let it be spirit-led. That's what it means to live a spirit-filled life. Now, the last verse is 20, and then I'll be out your way. Last verse is 20. What does it say? Verse 20. It says, giving thanks always for God, for all good things to God, Father. So, you could guess this one. You don't need to be a preacher to guess this one. Living a spirit-filled life means giving thanks to God in everything. Means giving thanks to God in everything. It means thanking God for everything. That goes back to understanding his purpose. You can't give God thanks because you don't understand his purpose. And even if you don't understand his purpose, if you begin to give him thanks, living a spirit-led life will reveal his purpose. So what are you saying, preacher? Live a life filled with giving thanks to God for everything that you go through. Not just good things, because we practice giving God thanks for the good things. Oh, my tax return came in early. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Ain't he good? Have mercy. Yes. That's a good thing. But can you give him thanks when things are not going good? Can you give him thanks in everything, in all situations? Giving God thanks in all situations is the key to living a spirit-led, spirit-filled life. I thank him when I feel like it. I thank him when I don't. I thank him when I'm sick. I thank him when I'm well. I thank him when I'm up. I thank him when I'm down. I thank him when I'm friendless. I thank him when I have all kinds of friends. Because when I think of the goodness of God and all that he has done for me, my soul cries out. I just want you to know that it's good to give thanks to God. Just don't thank him for the food. Just don't thank him for the table. Just don't thank him for the clothes. But thank him for the hard times. Because if it had not been for the hard times, I would not praise him in the good times. Thank him for the flood. Thank him for the fire. Thank him when I'm homeless. Thank him when I'm friendless. Thank him for all that he's done for me. Because God is still good. Being a spirit, being led by the Spirit means giving God thanks for everything you go through. See, that's the problem right there. You can't give God the thanks that for everything you go through because you can't see God's hand in it. But you got to give him some praise. Even when you can't see your way. Even when you don't know the way. Even when you don't know how he's going to make a way. If you just give God glory. If you just give God praise for what you're going through. I tell you the truth. That God will sustain you in your time of trial. In your time of trouble. Because the Bible tells us that he is a very present help. In the time of trouble, in the time of trial, in the time of tribulation, I may not have got everything right, but I tell you this, when I'm in trouble, I know God is there with me. When I'm in trials, I know God is there with me. He's walking with me. He's talking with me. He's right beside me. In every storm, every pain, every problem, I want you to know, so I thank him that I'm not going through by myself. I'm not friendless. I'm not homeless. I'm not alone. God is with me. God is walking with me. God is talking with me. So I just lift up my hands and I say, thank you that I'm not by myself. Thank you that I'm not in this trouble by myself. And when you begin to give God praise and you begin to give God glory, the Bible says that he inhabits the praises of his people. That's good word right there. He inhabits the praises of his people. And what's the benefit of God inhabiting the praise? When I begin to praise him, he begins to come down. Come down out of eternity. Come down out of eternity into my situation. And when God steps in my situation, everything that's not of God has to go. Oh, I tell you, darkness can't inhabit light. So God steps into my situation, and everything that's not of God has to go. Everything that's not of God has to leave. When I begin to praise him and he hears the praise out of my mouth, he begins to come down and cohabitate with me. That means he's living with me. He's walking with me. He's talking with me. And when God is with me, oh, I tell you, it's better than the whole world against me. I want to tell you, if you're living in wisdom and God is walking with you, oh, it's better than the whole world for you. He is. I'm here to tell you. See, it does you no good to know a whole lot of stuff and you can't apply it to your life. It does you no good to know a whole lot about Jesus if you can't apply it to your life. You can know everything from Genesis to maps, and if you can't apply it to your life, it does you no good. You can know scriptures from sunup to sundown. But when it starts to rain in your life, can you apply it? That's what I want to know. That means you can know the scriptures, but do you trust God enough to fulfill the scriptures in your life? That's what application is. Application is trusting God as standing on his word. God, this is what you said. Now I'm going to stand on what you said. What that means is that I'm not literally standing on it, but I'm figuratively standing on his word. I'm going to hold you to it. I will wait and see. I'm going to stand here and wait and see if you begin to fulfill what you said in my life. I know you said I wasn't going to be the tail, but I was going to be the head. You said I wasn't going to be below. You said I was going to be above. And God, right now, I feel like I'm gum at the bottom of somebody's shoe. But God, you told me that you were going to make me an overcomer. So I'm just going to stand here on your word as you begin to deliver me from everything that the enemy has set up for me. I'm going to praise you even though I don't know how you're going to get me there. I'm going to praise you even though I don't know how I'm going to make it, how I'm going to pay my bills, how I'm going to make a way. God, I don't know what, how I'm going to do it, but I believe you're able to do it in my life. So I praise him. The song says I praise him in advance. So how many of us are walking in wisdom? Walking in wisdom. Everybody stand. Everybody stand. Everybody. Walking. Walking in wisdom.